Welcome to Own or Disown, where tech decisions are made easy.
Hi, this is Stephen from Own or Disown. Well, one of my long-time subscribers, Teddy, asked me to review the 17-inch CLEVO X370 because it is a powerhouse of a system with three M.2 slots. I have always liked CLEVO systems. I actually still use my P870TM with the GTX 1080. They are easy to work on, and I would say for the most part, they're very reliable. Now, before we jump into the review, a quick word from today's sponsor, Magtame, a company that has designed a series of magnetic charging cables that are actually running a campaign on Kickstarter. Now, I am the complete opposite to a neat person. My drawers are filled with stuff, including many charging cables of various types. Now, I also have these cables across my floor, and I have lost count to how many care damage cables that I've had, with the rollers on my wheels running over the top of them. Now, Magtame did send me a couple of these cables to try out, and they coil up very nicely due to them being very magnetic, which makes them easy to store on your desk or on a hook or even in your bag without getting tangled up on things. I really liked how when I finish charging something, the cable coils up so it's less likely to end up under the wheels of my chair. Now for me, that is a big benefit and will save me money from the damaged cables. Now the cables are covered with a nylon braided fibre material that prevents them from getting kinked or knotted, and they are very strong, withstanding a pulling force of 30 kilograms. Now they are available as a flat cable or as a round cable, and you can get them with various combinations of micro USB, USB-A, USB-C or lightning connectors. There are two colour options, there's black or silver, as well as you can get either a 3 foot or 5 foot length of a cable. Now the early bird pricing is $19 for one cable, it's $29 for two, $39 for three, all the way up to $99 for nine. Now I have lost count to how many cables I have broken myself, or how many iPhone cables my kids have gone through. These cables from Magtame do look very robust, and will do something my wife has been trying to do for years, make my desk and floor a much neater place. So yeah, Hidevolution sent me the CLEVO X370 to review. All models have the 24-core, 32-thread i9-13900HX, and there are two panel options. Yeah, I can get a 2560 by 1440 and a 4K. Now, the 4080 model starts at $2,649, and the 4K model is $200 more. The RTX 4090 model starts at $3,099 for the QHD, and like my review model, the 4K model starts at $3,299. Now sure, you can buy a stock unit, but the advantage of buying from a system integrator like Hidevolution is that you can apply a paint protection film, you can apply a vinyl wrap, or do some laser engraving. Also, you can minimize backlight bleed, calibrate the display, or have a zero dead pixel guarantee. And the last option is very useful because once I did buy a Razer laptop and that had a dead pixel on it, and it severely reduced the resale price in the second-hand market. Now you can also change the amount of RAM and occupy all of the three M.2 slots. And finally, you can do a repaste and change the thermal pads. I did have one viewer who bought a stock model and it ran hot. So as you can see here, I asked Hidevolution to repaste it with Gelid GC Extreme and upgrade the thermal pads. They also offer a tuning and optimization package, which I hadn't heard of before. There are 12 steps they do that go beyond removing just bloatware. For example, removing Windows store apps that you don't want, removing Windows privacy invasion like the telemetry which sends your keystrokes to Microsoft. They can even restore the classic Windows 7 start menu, which I really liked. Hidevolution will create a system image onto a 128GB USB flash drive, allowing you to easily restore all the tweaks that were done. The first thing I noticed when unboxing it was that even though the system has a 175W RTX 4090, the power brick was pretty small and was only 280 watts. Now usually you will see a 330 watt brick with these specs, but not once did I see the battery drain when it was under load. Booting it up was a pleasure. It definitely seemed to be faster than most other systems I have used, but then again, the SSD read speeds were about 7000 megabytes per second. Hidevolution also loaded up my Own or Disown logo when it booted up, which I thought was a very nice touch. The X370 was snappy throughout all of my testing, more so than any other system that I had tested, so I do think their tuning did help in this regard. Now, the first thing you probably should do is go into the BIOS, because by default it didn't appear that the X370 had advanced Optimus, which it does. It was set to use a dedicated GPU only, so you can change that in the BIOS. There is an option called Battery Saver that will extend your battery life by reducing the screen brightness. And you probably have some leeway here, as out of the box it is 486 nits, and even at 50% brightness it is 268 nits, which is much brighter than most other systems. Watching YouTube at 50% brightness with all the Battery Saver features enabled allowed me to get about 2.5 hours from the 99 watt hour battery. So dropping to say 25% brightness at 140 nits may well be a good idea. That is the same brightness as many laptops at 50%. Now, there was no backlight bleed and the ghosting performance was good for a 144Hz panel. And if you want something faster, then just plumb for the QHD 240Hz. The panel had a colour gamut of 98% of sRGB and 83% of Adobe RGB with a contrast of 900:1, so no complaints from me. The chassis is black anodized aluminium and had no stickers on the palm rest, which is extremely refreshing to see. I like the clean look and it did a reasonable job of not showing the fingerprints. I found that those mostly showed up on the large touchpad and the keys themselves. The membrane keys are surrounded by white paint, making them easy to see in subdued light, and there's only one button, which is the power button. Now I do wish there was a button to activate, say, the fan speed or to change the power modes. You do have a per key RGB keyboard, which is plenty bright and is fully customizable via the software. The black aluminium lid is also very clean looking, with just the EVOC logo. There's no RGB on the lid or any RGB light bar, so it does fit well into a professional setting. I do wish that it had an SD card reader though, but still, you get two Thunderbolt 4 ports and two USB Type-A ports on the right hand side, and around the back there's a mini DisplayPort, HDMI, RJ45 and the rectangular power connector. The bottom cover is made out of aluminium, but the rear vent shroud is actually made out of plastic. Now there are good air intakes and the rear feet allow plenty of cool air into the system. And getting inside was a breeze. You can easily replace the Wi-Fi card, the RAM or any of the three M.2 SSD cards. Now I really do like the storage options here, you know, maxing out at 24TB and 64GB of RAM, so this system is a good desktop replacement, but yet only weighs 7.25 pounds, making it very portable. The software gives you four power modes. Extreme Performance, which in Cyberpunk 2077 sees the 4090 go to 165 watts and 81 degrees, and the 13900HX 82 watts and 96 degrees. This is with the auto fan, which produces a loud 62 decibels of noise. You also have Entertainment Mode, and this sees the 4090 drop to about 150 watts and the temperatures drop 5 degrees to 76 degrees Celsius. The 13900HX remains around 85 watts, yet its temperature drops from 96 to 86 degrees. The fan noise is still pretty loud though, at 60 decibels. Now this suggests that we have a shared heat pipe design, which is fine when doing CPU-only work, but in gaming, any increase in the GPU power will also increase the temperature of the CPU. Perhaps if Hidevolution applied liquid metal, we will see lower CPU temperatures in performance mode. How about power saver mode and quiet mode? Well, I'm sure the thermals are good with the CPU only at 15 watts and the GPU at 53 watts, but the frame rate is very low and the game stutters badly. Power saver fan noise is still quite loud at 55 decibels, so you might as well just use quiet mode at 38 decibels. Now, does frame generation help with the frame rates in these two lower power modes? Well, it does increase the frame rate a bit, but it is still unplayable at these settings. 4K, Ray Tracing Ultra and DLSS balanced. Now lowering the settings will be required. Performance mode was 10% faster than the cooler entertainment mode, which makes it equivalent to the RTX 4080 model. So if you want that extra performance you are paying for, you either have to live with the higher CPU thermals or use liquid metal. The lower power modes were playable in Shadow of the Tomb Raider, and compared to the other laptops I've tested, the X370 was in a league of its own. Here is Dead Space Remake at 4K, Ultra Settings and DLSS balanced. At the top is Extreme Performance Mode, and below it we are using Entertainment Mode. The former sees the 13900HX hit 100 degrees, whilst Entertainment Mode hits 93 degrees. I also ran it at 2560x1440, and the 4090 only had about a utilisation of 80%, suggesting, dare I say it, the CPU is bottlenecked with the 13900HX. Now, in extreme performance mode, the X370 and its 4090 is 8% faster than the RTX 4080 at 2560 by 1600 resolution. Although the Alienware M18 didn't fare so well, only being 18% faster than the X370, which was at 4K. Now I show Hogwarts Legacy at 4K using high settings, ray tracing at high, and DLSS set to balance with no frame generation. Now I must say, the X370 ran this game the best out of all the laptops I've tested, with little to no stuttering. The 13900HX again hits 100 degrees in extreme performance mode, whilst in entertainment mode it reaches a much better 92 degrees. Showing the frame rates at 1440p so I can compare against some RTX 4080 laptops, and I must say at 4K the X370 performs brilliantly. 5% higher than even the 4080, which was tested at 1440p. Now, at the same resolution, the RTX 4090 was 12% faster than the 4080, making the 16% extra cost for the 4090 perhaps somewhat more palatable. Again, to get decent thermals, we use the entertainment mode, which we get the same performance level as the RTX 4080. The software does allow you to adjust the fan speed of the CPU and the GPU independently, as well as change the multipliers for both the performance cores and the efficiency cores. You can also adjust the power limits of the CPU and apply an undervolt, all three of which can be used to lower the CPU temperature. Now, I did try applying an undervolt using this software, as well as using throttle stop, but it didn't show up in HW info, and I tested it in Battlefield 2042 and saw no difference in CPU temperatures. So I suspect the undervolt didn't work, even though I had the overclocking feature enabled in the BIOS. In Assassin's Creed Valhalla, the 4090 was 10% faster than the 4080, and even entertainment mode was 6% faster. I also include the result from the 105W RTX 4090 in the MSI Stealth 17 Studio, so you can see what those extra 70 watts can do for you. 31% faster for 66% more power. Far Cry 6 is pretty CPU dependent, so I was quite surprised to see a 25% boost over the RTX 4080 laptops. Even at 4K, it matched last year's champ, the 3080 Ti, which was using the lower 1440p resolution. In some games like Watch Dogs Legion, using 4K Ultra settings and Ray Tracing Ultra with no DLSS, entertainment mode matched extreme performance mode and was 9% faster than the 4080. Now, 4K at 35fps is borderline playable, so you may want to use DLSS. As for the GPU Timespy score, the laptop 4090 beats even the desktop 3090, which is a little over 20,000 points, so that is not bad at all. For CPU work, the 13900HX scored a respectable 28,600 points in Cinebench R23 multi-core test and 2,000 in the single-core test. As for the latency mon test, it failed very quickly, with Nvidia and Windows drivers being the main culprits. Here is what the webcam is like. So we have a 720p webcam. Looks okay, but it does pick up the background noise quite a bit here. And this is so it's like when you're typing. So what did I think of the EVOC X370? Well, I think the tuning that Hidevolution did was very good, and I do recommend that. The X370 has plenty of storage options, which also is a big plus. I also like its minimalist design, so it can be used in many situations. The 4K panel I had was good for both gaming and content creation. And I was also very impressed with how stable the system was. It was the first RTX 4000 laptop that I've used that had zero stutters in any game I tried. Now, that alone makes it worth considering. Now, what didn't I like? Well, the CPU temperature was high in extreme performance mode. It made it perform, you know, if I used the entertainment mode, it did make it perform like an RTX 4080 laptop. I didn't have time to lower the CPU multipliers, so you can try that, or setting the CPU to use, say, 55 watts, but then that would affect non-gaming performance. Perhaps having Hidevolution pace it with liquid metal would actually help. Still, I think that aside, I think it's worth buying for its responsiveness and smooth gameplay alone. Thank you for watching. Bye now.